Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel, welcome back to another video, and today we are doing part 3 of my end of the 2020 extravaganza. If you missed the previous parts, I will link those below. The first part is my entire book haul for the year, the second part is the very long dive into my least favorite books of all time. And since I'm sure you have seen the title, you know that this is the inevitable opposite to that video, my most favorite books of all time. It's kind of odd the difference in depth you can get into between good and bad books. I feel like with bad books, for the most part, you can articulate what makes them so bad. You know, annoying characters, dumb plot, nonsensical story. And in my experience, it seems like most booktubers usually point out that their rant or bad reviewed videos get the most views. So we all seem attracted to that style. But with good books, and I'm also guilty of this, I don't think that we watch or read reviews for as much because it's usually hard to articulate what makes them so good. So that being said, this video should be shorter, but I also have far more favorite books, which honestly, thank goodness. I would hate that if I was so critical and negative that I had more books that I hate. But according to Goodreads, I have 13 books on my worst books list, two of those I'm saving for my least favorite books of 2020 list, and I have about 26 of my favorites. Now granted, some of these are books of the same series, so I can sort of just put those all together into one if I like the series as a whole. And I'm very happy to say that a whole 9 of them are from 2020, so those won't make this list as I will discuss those in my favorite books of 2020. Without further ado though, let's get into my favorite books of all time. Harry Potter. I feel like I don't even need to elaborate. What is there to say? I grew up on this series. It did more than just get me into reading. It helped me explore new magical worlds. I think it's the reason I pull back the veil of our common world to step into something more. Besides just what it did for me nostalgia-wise and how it shaped my creative nature, I really love the world. I love the school setting, I love the friendship, and to this day I still imagine my own Hogwarts student walking in those halls. And then for those who aren't aware, there's actually an RPG game coming out in 2021. I really don't want to look too much into it, I'm nervous of getting my hopes up, but I'm just excited to live my dream as a Hogwarts student. Okay, so the most obvious one is out of the way. Let's move on to Carry On. Yes, if you know the story, it's not a very far difference from Harry Potter. This is essentially a purposefully inspired novel based off of Harry Potter. It is also about a magical school with the main character battling the big bad guy, and the main character is a chosen one of sorts. But there are actually a lot of key differences. Like, he's actually not a very good chosen one, and the Hagrid character is actually like one of the most powerful wizards, and the Dumbledore character is basically what would have happened if Albus didn't learn from his mistakes after his sister's death. It's a male-on-male romance to boot, with the Draco character becoming the love interest of our main character. I really cherish this novel, and it's not even because it's sort of like Harry Potter. The similarities are there, but there's just so much little nuance and changes to Carry On that it's its own thing. My next favorite is a contemporary, I'll Give You the Sun by J.D. Nesslin. This story has two main protagonists, twins, but interestingly enough, they each occupy a different timeline, a before and after their mother's death. The brother's point of view being the past before the mother's death, and the sister's is the present after their mother's death. I love this story because it's just so beautiful. It also has a male-on-male romance and is hugely centered around art. Seeing these two artists struggle with the loss and their personal goals is incredibly compelling, all the while we are slowly trying to uncover a mystery surrounding their mother. I don't get too emotional when reading, but this book definitely hit those emotions. So after that is the Summoner series by Taryn Matharu. I'd be very interested to reread these because I first flew through them really early in my book community career, but I remember loving these. To me, it felt like a cross of like Aragorn meets Pokemon. Oh, and it also happens to have a magic school. The main character is unapologetically wholesome. He is a genuinely good person, patient and kind, and a fighter for those underprivileged. I love this world and the main character, plus he has a little salamander companion. What's not to love? After that is another trilogy and another male-on-male romance. This is the Captive Prince trilogy. I originally first heard of this due to its controversy, so beware for trigger warnings for like sexual assault, abuse, and slavery. To me, this stuff didn't really bother me. If you like Game of Thrones or Spartacus, this isn't really anything worse than that. This story has our main character, a prince of one nation, betrayed and sent as a slave to their enemy. The enemy doesn't know who he is, so our main character has to keep quiet. He then meets our secondary main character, who is incredibly hard to like for a long time. But as you read through, you start to understand that his situation is far more perilous than he lets on, and you begin to sympathize with him. Our main character is so kind and strong, and is a great lens to view this world through. The secondary main character is cool, calculating, but brilliant. I love the political intrigue of this book and the slow burn bond that grows between the two characters. So let's head on back to Earth for a very grounded contemporary story, Running with Lions by Julian Winters. This one is very personal to me. It may not work for everyone, but it may have been written specifically for me. This came out in 2018, but it perfectly captured how I felt going through middle school and high school in the late 2000s. It has a queer cast, it is set in the summer at a summer camp, my favorite season, and it's for their soccer team, which is a sport I played at that age. The main character Sebastian is that one friend that always holds his whole friends together, the designated driver, me again, but he also has self-esteem issues, big time me again. I actually love how this is written in the novel. You see all the signs that there's something there, but Sebastian doesn't really seem to be making a big deal of it. Kind of like society in general, sometimes male self-esteem and how we look just isn't seen as a big deal. But there's a scene where it all just sort of bubbles over and the emotions feel so real and raw. Sebastian and his friends are attending another summer of soccer camp, but an old friend from Sebastian's past returns and he has to try to merge everyone together. There are some amazing character moments, and that cover is just everything aesthetically pleasing to me. I think it's a perfect summer read if you want something sweet and simple, and a reminder of just how much easier life was when you were younger. In my review, I said it's good for anyone going into high school, in high school, or even more importantly, after high school. It can really help you process that you weren't alone and that the way your life turns out is okay, and I still stand by that to this day. Next one is a big one, the Mistborn series, and I do mean the whole series. But weirdly enough, I'm gonna split Era 1 and Era 2 since I feel like they occupy two different parts of my creative soul. Mistborn by Brandon Sanderson is an incredible series. It begins with book 1, introducing us to a world that is forever covered in a haze. Every couple of days, ash falls from the sky, a red sun is visible through the gray clouds, because 1,000 years ago, the Chosen One battled a big villain, and the Chosen One lost. This story lives in that world. There are individuals who use allomancy, which is a type of power that allows them to swallow certain metals and kind of burn them to use their power. Each person gifted with allomancy usually can only be gifted with one of these various powers, but then there are the Mistborn, extremely rare allomancers that can burn all the metals, and our main character is one such allomancer. Vin is first introduced, and I gotta say, I wasn't a fan. She wasn't that great, but Sanderson really gives us the reasons why, and we see her growth through all three books. This world is slowly revealed to us throughout the books, and the ending of book 1 and 2 hitting you with hard revelations. I could clearly make a whole video about Mistborn, it's incredible, and I learned a lot when paying attention to how Sanderson sets up his novel. The foreshadowing from the first to third books is masterful. There are few books that make an incredibly unique and compelling world, while also making incredibly compelling characters. Both elements to these first three books are outstanding and get my highest praise. It's kind of funny looking at my list. Besides Sanderson, the rest of my novels are all queer books, or at least have some kind of like male-on-male representation. The next series fits one of those, and that is the Skybound series by Alex London. Black Winds Beating being the first, and Red Skies Falling being the second. The final third book is already out, but I haven't gotten to it yet. This series is set in a pretty immersive avian world. The culture and religions are based around the birds of prey. We follow twins Bryson and Kylie. One has a brutal past who, even into book 3, is still dealing with this, and the other has a gift that is ancient and forbidden to most people. What I love about this series is how immersed I can be in it. I feel the language and the culture he uses doesn't seem cheesy or unnecessary, and in this incredible, real-feeling world is two extremely compelling characters. Their love for each other and their companions is extremely touching. The second one continues this trend and rarely pulls any punches, as consequences are abound. A war with those who despise the avian lovers grows to a fever pitch, and everything is just so intense and stakes are like at an all-time high. It's a gripping emotional ride and I loved it. Going to pull us back to Earth on this next one, because we're going to talk about the hilarious and gay contemporary novel Red, White, and Royal Blue by Casey McQuiston. This is an enemies to lovers story with one of the best first chapters. I didn't know I wanted to actually read it when I first started it. For a while, I was just reading the first chapter of every book I bought before I put it on my shelf, and I'm glad I did because I didn't put it down after that. We have the main character Alex, the son of the president, falling for Henry, the Prince of England. This book is so fun and sweet. I think I want to read it soon. In my review, it says chapter 10 is everything, and I don't really remember what happened, so I kind of want to read about it again because I don't quite remember it. This next one is pretty popular. Most people have heard of the Percy Jackson series. A couple of years ago, I heard the amazing news that he was making a spin-off series of Apollo. I was ecstatic. Of all the gods in the pantheon, he ended up going with my favorite Greek god. This series has Apollo losing his godly powers and having to go on a quest as a mortal. I'm not gonna lie, I was really biased when I rated the first book. I gave it too high of a rating, but I'm actually here to talk about book two. I absolutely loved the sequel. At the time of making this video, I haven't read the fifth and final book, but as of now, I still think that this is the best in the series. We see amazing growth in Apollo and his companion. We have some great cameos from past characters, and the bond Apollo has with the villain is actually very deep and kind of sad. We meet a new group of characters that stole my heart, and Apollo gets some of his powers back. There was just so much in this book that completely bumped up this series for me. We will be returning to Sanderson with Mistborn Era 2. Yes, I know it's hard to believe, but I actually love Era 2 just as much as Era 1, and for different reasons. For those who may not know, Era 2 of Mistborn takes place about 300 years after the first trilogy. It's actually amazing to fall in love with Era 1 and then see what happens to it. The heroes and actions we learned about firsthand are now legend. I personally love the Victorian sort of steampunk transition of the series. Sanderson continues to develop the Elemantic magic system, and I was also enjoying the more lighthearted plot. Don't get me wrong, serious stuff still happens, but it's not really world-ending or overthrowing evil dictators. The characters are amazing, and one of the couples is actually probably one of the best I think Sanderson has ever set up, my opinion, second only to Shallan and Adolin. Speaking of which, it's time for the big one. The Stormlight Archives is the last book on my list. I think I'm in the minority when I say that the first book, Way of Kings, doesn't actually make this list, and is so far my least favorite. But so far, the series as a whole is amazing. The world Sanderson is creating, in my humble opinion, is on the complexity with Middle Earth. Like, as I'm reading Rhythm of War right now, I feel like I need to take a refresher course on all things Stormlight and within the Cosmere. But even when I'm not fully understanding everything about the books, what's happening in each story, the immediate plot, and the characters are phenomenal. He builds some spectacular moments and scenes. These are some of the deepest characters with a multitude of complexities. You can tell Sanderson really worked hard to learn how different people handle mental and physical disabilities. The traumas these characters have are very deep and affects them through like most of these monstrous tomes. It's not just like, oh hey, here's like a compelling backstory and like get over it. It builds and it reflects their character and it like changes how they view things and do things. They're amazing. I just can't praise how deep these characters are or how fascinating this world is. But seriously, I need a Stormlight Archives class. So that's it. I have 9 more books that are on my favorites list of all time, but I can't believe they are all from 2020. That's amazing, honestly. But I hope that gives you a little insight to what I love. Please let me know down below what you thought about these books, and please leave any suggestions for books you think I'd like based off of my list. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you all next time. Bye now.